Thank you all so much for coming tonight. We're calling this event a public forum, and it was really arranged at the last moment as a kind of ad hoc event in response basically to all the uproar that was happening a couple of weeks ago around the terrible Charlie Hebdo event. But it's the kind of thing that hopefully we can do on occasion here at the Divinity School. We really felt that it's an important type of event that people can come together, have some comments, and just air and discuss together what are sometimes actually quite controversial, but also very pertinent issues to not only the study of religion, but to the world, to all kinds of important political and other sorts of issues. And here's Jeff Seul, so thanks, I'm glad you made it. I want to thank, first of all, the staff in the dean's office at the Divinity School for their hard work in putting this together at the last moment, and also to the speakers who were so kind to agree to make a statement on this also at the last moment. I'm Janet Gyatso, the Associate Dean of Academic Affairs, and I'm going to be moderating tonight. I'm just going to say one or two very brief comments, and then we'll get to our speakers. So I just wanted to note that the Charlie Hebdo event is what catalyzed us to have this forum tonight, but really we hope and we're intending to speak about a lot of other issues as well and a lot of other times and places in the news more recently from anywhere from Nigeria to Peshawar to Ferguson, and people not being able to breathe in Staten Island, just to name a few. And in fact, the mere fact that it was Charlie Hebdo that catalyzed the event does make us wonder whether it's true that brown and black lives really matter less than white lives. It's the kind of issue that we may be discussing tonight. So these kinds of questions are going to broaden the purview of what we're speaking about tonight considerably. But even if we only stick to the Charlie Hebdo event itself, and while there have been a lot of voices in response to that, all the way from outrage to applause even, and everything in between, we also do have a fundamental question or a set of questions about how to frame it all, especially for us in an academic institution of higher learning like the Divinity School or a liberal arts university. Is it indeed about the freedom of speech? Or you might say the responsibility that goes along with the freedom of speech, as the Pope himself commented soon after the event. Or I'm just quoting now Walter Fluker, who was speaking on Martin Luther King Day at the Memorial Church, who was citing actually the Dalai Lama on his views on the insistence that justice and compassion always have to go together. Or is the event and the issues before us really about social and economic disparity and injustice? Or is it about imperialism? Is it about religion? Islam, Judaism, Zionism? All that's going to be fair game tonight. And my hope is only that in the nature of our discussion, that we will, at least in some degree, take inspiration from Martin Luther King's notion of beloved community, at least to the extent that we're able to sit together and talk about controversial issues openly and fairly and listen to others' opinions as we talk about them. We're not here to solve these huge problems that we have. We're just here to think and speak together. I don't know what any of our panelists are going to say at all, but I can guarantee you that it's going to be very varied and it's going to be food for thought. So let me introduce them very briefly. How it's going to work is that each speaker has been told very sternly by me that they may only speak at the most for 7 minutes, and hopefully less, because we really want to have a chance to have back and forth between you, the audience, and the speakers. So our speakers in alphabetical order, and let me just say again how much I thank all of them for being willing to speak at such short notice. Jocelyne Cesari, who is a lecturer on Islamic studies here at the Divinity School, and she's also the director of the Islam in the West program at Harvard. Anila Dalazzi, who is a research associate in the women's the WSRP program. I can't remember what it stands for. I'm sorry. Something about women and research. She's here for a year, and she's also a visiting associate professor of women's studies and Islamic studies here. And Charles Hallisey, who is a senior lecturer here at the Divinity School on Buddhist literatures. Mark Jordan, who is professor of Christian thought here at the Divinity School and also has a joint appointment in the department, what is it, WGS, it's another one that I never remember. Women, gender, sexuality in the art. Ousmane Kane, who is professor of contemporary Islamic religion and society here at the Divinity School and also has an appointment in NELC, whatever that stands for. And, and Jeffrey Seul, who is the chairman of the Peace Appeal Foundation, and he's also a partner in the law firm of Holland and Knight. So I'm going to just go in alphabetical order, so I'll call on Jocelyne Cesari first.
Good evening. I would like to frame the recent events in Paris in a perspective that is broader than just looking at the freedom of press or freedom of speech and so-called intolerance of the Islamic religion. And we'd like to provide some insight on a way that is to pay more attention to a dialectic that has been going on for now decades in Europe, but I would say more broadly in Western societies when it comes to Muslim, which is this confrontation between, you call this Islamophobia versus what I call Westphobia. And I will explain that in more words. So the Islamophobia term, I don't like it very much because I don't think it does reflect what is really at stake, which is the lack of symbolic integration of Islam. And symbolic integration of Islam is not socio-economic integration of Muslims. It's something else. It has to do with the lack of acceptation or recognition that Islam is part now of the main staple of European national cultures and religious landscape. And we have to be clear here, European governments have done a lot in terms of attempts to integrate Muslims, socioeconomically speaking, with more or less success, but this is not the point here. But nothing has been done to integrate Islam. So what we have witnessed in the last 15 or 20 years is a rise of concern from different segments of European society that Islam is not compatible and cannot be absorbed into the main liberal values of secular democracies. So what does it mean? It means that if you look at several incidents that have even brought attention here in America about the minaret controversy, campaigns against building places of worship, campaigns against allowing halal food, campaigns against dress code, and even more recently, campaigns against circumcision. What you are witnessing here is a clear anxiety. I'm not underestimating it or saying it's bad. There is an anxiety also of European citizens that is not addressed about the capacity of being a Muslim, an assertive Muslim, and a good citizen, and the reaction or attempt of most European governments has been to try to contain, curtail, and sometimes limit the capacity of Muslims to practice their religion. And what I'm saying here has nothing to do with terrorism and security. It is caused by terrorism and security. But beyond looking at the profiling of terrorists, what we have seen in Europe, and there are sufficient data about that, is a clear attempt to limit the practice of Islam because in itself, the practice of Islam is seen as uncivic and potentially terrorists. So this is the background in which most of Muslims are living. And it is not only a discourse, because usually you look at the discourse. What we have is clear evidence that it does influence the way that civil servants anonymously in different administrations are going to interact with people either wearing the hijab or having special requests or specificity when it comes to education of their children or dietary rules and so forth, or requests on the workplace. It does have this kind of consequences. And we know that Muslims have to deal with that. Does it mean that you have to kill people because they are not respecting your religion? Of course not. I mean, this should never be something to even think or say. And what is interesting to me, if we look at the freedom of speech, that, you know, now European, and that's very interesting to me, the French, you know, presenting themselves as the defender of freedom of speech. There is no free ticket when it comes to freedom of speech in Europe. Everywhere in Europe, unlike the US, you have a limitation on freedom of speech based on the trauma that was the Second World War and the Holocaust. So you have legislation that prevents you to incite hatred, racial hatred, and to negate the Holocaust. So what we have witnessed also in the last 15 years is the attempt by Muslim groups to be also protected by these laws. And they were never heard, never, ever. So, for example, the Danish cartoons. You could argue, is it critique, is it satire, or is it insult? I know that the line is sometimes very blurry. But lots of Muslim groups put it to the trial, to the court, and said, you know, maybe there is something here that is about racial hatred or incitation to racial hatred, and it was not heard. And so this is something we have to take into account, because this what you hear everywhere, Islamophobia, actually explain why some young people with a Muslim background or converting to Islam can be very fragile to a global political discourse coming from some Muslim groups like ISIS or Al-Qaeda, because we know that the Quraishi brothers were not two lambda citizens. They were part of networks of radical activists. And why I'm insisting on that? Because this brings me to the second part of it, what I call the West phobia. There is a dimension of West phobia in all the radical Islamic group operating today internationally. And the two feed each other in the sense that if you listen to the rhetoric and justification of violence by this radical group, is to say that the West is the enemy of Islam, but not the enemy only militarily or economically or because they occupy land. It's an ontological enemy of Islam. It is the fact that if the West is here to kill the soul of Muslims. 0 minute, nothing left. Okay, so so if I bring my two pieces together, it means that we are here in a very dangerous and lethal feeding of each other, the West phobia feeding, the Islamophobia, and vice versa. One way to get out of that would be politically to build in Europe or in the West a narrative where Islam is part of the national communities. I saw one sign of that during the march. This was the first time that you could see young Muslims, not leaders, not religious figures, bringing signs saying, I am Charlie, I am a Jew, and not in my name. I don't know if this emotional moment will keep going, but this would be the way to go. Sorry.
Thank you so much. It's going to be true for all of our speakers are going to be saying great things, so it's my painful job to have to stop them, because each of them could speak for a very long time. Charles Hallisey.
The references to my name, my formal police blotter name is Charles, but I'm pretty universally known as Charlie. The references to my name puts me in a category of people, those of us who are named Charles and have the nickname Charlie, that can't say the statement, I am Charlie, I am not Charlie, as a political statement. It either sounds as a truism, I am Charlie, or that I am not Charlie and I'm teaching Buddhism again. The fact that I am incapable of making, using this, I am Charlie, I am not Charlie, as a political statement, is a reminder that we are in Cambridge, a reminder that what Tip O'Neill said, all politics is local, and that part of what we need to do is to remind ourselves we're not in Paris, we're not in Nigeria, we're not elsewhere, we are in an imperial nation. But we are in Cambridge, and we're at Harvard Divinity School, and to think about, well, what does this mean for us here? When Tip O'Neill said that all politics is local, he was saying that there was something to be avoided of talking about big and intangible ideas, and instead to focus on things that could be done locally for the sake of a future that those ideas could help. It used to be that we see on bumper stickers quite a lot, think globally, act locally, in a certain sense, is something for us to remember in terms of, for us to ask the questions, what's the significance of having this event about events so far away? Because it's very, very significant for us here. One thing I just want to notice in the way that the title of our event today, Violence, Freedom of Expression, and Justice, it's just notice that freedom of expression is something that belongs to individuals, and justice belongs to institutions, I think. Freedom of expression is a right of individuals, but justice appears in the world because of what institutions do. And so this is a political thing as well as a moral thing, and we want to think about the fact that we are people who are in an important institution. Not that Harvard is important, but that we're important in an important institution of universities. And to think about how is it that universities as institutions take their place in the world to encourage justice, and not just to be neoliberal institutions that are always claiming the significance of individual freedom of expression. We are at Harvard Divinity School, and so thinking about the local was to remember that when I was a student here in the 70s, James Luther Adams was still teaching here. His house is behind the WSRP. I don't know what the acronym stands for either. But the gray house there, a very nicely architecturally designed house. He was teaching at Harvard Divinity School then. He was a major theologian of liberal religion. And we could say that we want to remember that this is not a liberal institution alone, it is an institution of liberal religion. It is a place that has been shaped by Unitarian, Universalist traditions. And even for those of us who are not Unitarians, I'll remind Dudley that he's always telling me that everyone's a Unitarian. But that for those of us who are not Unitarians, we might still be able to affirm what Luther Adams referred to as the five smooth stones of liberal theology. Very nice image, the five smooth stones. They've come from being jumbled together, the rough and tumble of a hard world. One is that truth is not closed, but is constantly being revealed. No one has it. We have to look for it to come. All relations between persons ought ideally to rest on mutual free consent and not coercion. Freedom of expression is in there. This is very important for me. Affirmation of the moral obligation to direct one's effort toward the establishment of a just and loving community. A very striking thing. A moral obligation to direct one's effort, both as an individual and as a member of an institution, to establishing a just and loving community. Denial of the immaculate conception of virtue. An affirmation of the necessity of social incarnation of virtue, of justice. How is it that justice is incarnated in this institution? Good must be consciously given form and power within history. We all know that things that are not good have more than enough resources to find form and power within history. It takes more imagination, more effort to bring them into incarnation in history. So these are questions that we can ask. Oh, we are the inheritors, our inheritance of a liberal religion here at Harvard Divinity School that has shaped it in the way that it is. How do we turn it into our legacy, in which we say we want to hand it on in ways that may not be Unitarian in every way, but they are five good smooth stones. I also want to just concentrate on institutions. We belong to a university, and how to think about a university, how to think about, well, not just that we're in a divinity school as part of a university, but the significance of universities. In contemporary political theory, there's something that people have come up with that they refer to as liberal institutionalism. This is not about the liberal values. It's about how institutions exist in the world. Institutionalism rejects the realist assumption that international politics is a struggle for power in which security issues are top priority. It argues that instead, we can imagine a world in which actors other than states participate directly in world politics, in which a clear hierarchy of issues does not exist, and in which force is an ineffective instrument of policy. We can challenge ourselves and say, how can we create Harvard into such an institution that doesn't promote security and justify state violence, but instead takes a place trying to create a different kind of world in which it allows for itself that there's not a clear hierarchy of issues that exist. And we can begin here to try to figure out how is it among ourselves that we learn to listen to each other, in which we learn how to live in a world institutionally, in which there's not a clear hierarchy of issues apart from justice, that we're trying to figure out how to hand on this institution to create justice and not just over individual rights. So a couple of things that we may have to learn how to do better. We're academics and we all like to see things from many different angles. It's another way of saying we have a hard time of staying on topic. We start talking about this, but we always have something else we want to talk about. This is a skill that we're very bad at. We can contribute to the world of learning how to do that so that when we start talking about one thing, we're not talking about something else. And to just say, oh, can we learn how to focus on what is in complicated issues, whether it's in Pakistan, Nigeria, Paris. God knows there's enough complicated issues here in Cambridge that are multifaceted. How do we learn how to focus on it and not step sideways and avoid the hard work by changing the topic? So we need to learn how to do that better. We need to learn how to be more self-conscious about ourselves, that we're both scholars and teachers and students and citizens. And sometimes our feelings as citizens get in the way of what we know as scholars. We need to recognize that we are in this institution that we're in, it's not as liberal as we might like it to think. This is the factory that made the clash of civilizations. And we may not like it in this room, but it was made here, it's our brand, and it's out in the world. And it's part of policy. We have to learn how to say, in rooms here, it's wrong. And not get away with the way that people, you know, talk about, oh, there's a clash of civilization. And that justifies us doing other kinds of things. One other thing, because we're in a divinity school and we study religion, we want to learn how to do it better. Sometimes it's going back to things that we already know. A long time ago, when Wilfred Smith was still alive, he was retired, but in many ways, his thinking is in the woodwork of this room and other things here at Harvard Divinity School. I was teaching over in Harvard Yard, doing stuff with undergraduates, and at a seminar for sophomore, second-year students who were just concentrating in religion. Wilfred Smith was in town, and I asked him, comments, tell people who are just beginning the study of religion what you want them to know after you've spent your life studying religion. And he said something that I wasn't prepared for. He said, I made a big mistake. I underestimated how evil religion is. I only thought it was something that we had to retrieve the good from it, protected against secularism, protected about other kinds of things. But I underestimated how evil religion is. We inherit a tradition of the study of religion here at Harvard that we could say is romantic. We want to see the good in religion. We see ourselves as curating it, speaking for it, affirming how good it is. There's another tradition in the study of religion we can attribute to people like Marx, Enlightenment, a tradition that says there's something wrong with religion. We want to learn how to speak with that too and not get upset that we might be out of a job if we start to say, oh, that religion's bad. But part of what for me to say is that I feel that the answers to some of the things that bring us together here that are very, very serious, very, very important. But part of it is for us to think about ourselves. How do we live in rooms like this? And how do we challenge ourselves to say, I want to hand on an institution that I'm part of for now, that in the future people will say, it's still for justice. And that's part of the challenge that we need to do.
Thank you so much. Mark Jordan, please.
To me, as surely to some of you, the attack on Charlie Hebdo felt peculiarly personal. Not that I read the magazine regularly or find its playground humor very funny. I prefer South Park on religion. But the attack felt personal because these murders were committed on artists and writers who had mocked religion. Since I write and since I sometimes mock some religion, it felt to me as if mass gunmen had come into this lecture hall to carry out executions. I'm also Christian, and so the unlikely adherent of a religion with a horror of blasphemy. It is easier for me to think about Charlie Hebdo not in the Enlightenment categories of religious neutrality and freedom of speech, but through episodes in the history of blasphemy and Christendom. On July 11, 1977, a fortnightly newspaper in London was found guilty of blasphemy for publishing a poem. The publication was accused of a blasphemous libel concerning the Christian religion, namely an obscene poem and illustration vilifying Christ in his life and his resurrection. The publication and its editor were found guilty. Both were fined, and the editor was sentenced to 9 months imprisonment. The sentence was overturned on appeal. The fines were not. The newspaper was The Gay News. The poem judged blasphemous was entitled The Love That Dares to Speak Its Name. Written by James Kilcup, it describes same-sex acts with Jesus. The poem is graphic, as we say. It is also very bad, as even its author will tell you. It was not written to be great poetry. It was written to provoke Christian pieties that protect the body of Jesus Christ from any contamination by sexual desire, especially homosexual desire. And yet, the poem provokes these pieties to proclaim a more generous gospel of salvation. The graphic and terrible poem professes that Christ will redeem those rejected in his name. Reflect with me on this story, because it can remind us of four things that may help us to think, to register the slaughter at Charlie Hebdo. First, obviously, blasphemy is not a category peculiar to Islam. It is a category in many religions, and many religions have done their best to write that category into the civil law of local regimes. The blasphemy law under which Gay News was prosecuted was finally repealed only 6 years ago. You may also know that there is still today a blasphemy law in Massachusetts. Nor is prohibition of religious images peculiar to Islam. recall the long and gruesome controversy over icons in Eastern Christianity, or remember how many church buildings in the Netherlands and England still display the fury of Calvinist reformers and their sledgehammers. Second, strong reaction to blasphemy are not hard to understand. If you love a god, gods, prophets, or messengers, you will react to insults. Even though I am a gay man, I find it hard to read Kilcup's poem. Its deliberate provocations do provoke me, and not just aesthetically. And while I try hard not to let provocation drive my response, I never want to be ashamed of feeling offended by an insult to something I revere. For me, at least, the ethical ideal cannot be to permit only tepid religious sentiments. No, the challenge is to learn to live together peacefully with strong religious convictions. Third, this challenge has to be faced inside a religious tradition as much as outside it. Charges of blasphemy are often lodged against religious reformers, indeed against reformers of many kinds. So far as I know, Massachusetts has the distinction of being the last state in the Union to jail someone for blasphemy, the ex-universalist Abner Kneeland in 1838. But the same statute was used almost a century later in 1928 against the communist Anthony Bimba. Bimba was accused of denying the existence of God and the divinity of Christ. He also said that capitalists conspired with bishops to run the government, which sounds about right to me. But it's interesting to consider which statement irritated the state more. Whatever their alleged motivation, charges of blasphemy are frequently used to suppress movements for religious, legal, or moral reform. It is often not God who is vindicated by prosecution of blasphemy. Fourth, finally, a strong religious tradition should be able to practice patience with blasphemy, whether without or within. In the Christian tradition, there is even an old name for this kind of patience. It is called toleration. Traditionally, Christian writers commend the toleration of some religious evils because trying to purify the world instantly is in fact trying to do better than God, whose providence permits religious evils. I'm not commending this argument so much as reminding you that even religious traditions with a horror of blasphemy teach compensating lessons of patience and restraint, not to say commandments against the murder of innocents. Why the complexity of religious teaching is so often lost in our public debates or in our mass media? That is an urgent question for another conversation. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Two more speakers, Professor Ousmane Khan.
Thank you, Janet, for inviting me to join this panel. I was born and I grew up in Senegal, West Africa, and Senegal is a predominantly Muslim country. 95% of Senegalese are Muslim. Senegal is also a deeply religious country, and religiosity can be measured by mosque attendance, the regular observance of the five daily prayers, fasting during the month of Ramadan, etc. And a few years ago, the Pew Forum on Religion in Public Life conducted a poll about religious commitment in the world. And respondents were asked, how important is religion in their life? So the highest response rate in the whole world was recorded in Senegal, where 98% of Muslims responded that religion is very important in their life. And 5% of the Senegalese are Christians, but religion is as important for them as it's for their Muslim compatriot. Senegal is also a success story of democracy. It is the only country in Africa or in West Africa that never experienced military rule, And in the whole African continent, it is one of four countries. The other three are Botswana, Mauritius, and Cabo Verde. When authoritarian rule was the norm in most countries of the world and long before the third wave of democratization, Senegal had organized regular elections, including two presidential elections in which the incumbent candidate was defeated and alternation of political power was peaceful. Throughout the post-colonial period, there has been considerable respect for civil liberties, including freedom of expression. Another feature of Senegal is also peaceful religious coexistence. The founding father of the country, Leopold Sédar Senghor, was a Roman Catholic who was supported by Muslim brotherhoods. I think it's fair to say that Senegal is as free a country as most advanced liberal democracies, at least now. Senegal was a former French colony, and it is tied to France by a long history. And when the French government organized the rally to denounce the Charlie Hebdo killings and the attacks against the Jewish supermarket, some 40 heads of state, as we know, have joined, including the president of Senegal. But when he returned home, the next thing that the president of Senegal did, Macky Sall, was to ban the issue of Charlie Hebdo with the picture, "I am Charlie, everything is forgiven." So he was challenged by journalists for not being coherent. How can he join the rally in support of, quote unquote, freedom of expression and restrict that same freedom by banning the issue of Charlie Hebdo? And he responded that he was part of the rally to express his sympathy to the French people and to denounce the violence of religious groups. But he did not approve the cartoons. I am not sure that President Sall knew that Senegal is arguably the most religious country in the world, but he said that in a country like ours, like Senegal, some representation of the prophet would hurt people's feelings so badly that as a president, it was his responsibility to take action against it. And I was in Senegal when the killings happened, and I spent most of the month of January in Senegal. And nothing that I heard or read in Senegal indicated that this tolerant country accepted that it was okay to publish some pornographic representations of the Prophet, peace be upon him. I spent many years in France, where I received my undergraduate and graduate education. And in contrast to Senegal, France might be the country where the commitment to religious practice is among the lowest in the world. There is a long tradition of anti-clericalism, and the French people are committed to freedom of expression as they understand it, including the right to reproduce those kinds of representation that may shock believers. I think that President Sall's position reflected very much what Senegalese and perhaps most Muslims felt about what happened. They reject the murderous ideology of jihadi groups whose actions caused the loss of life, but also expose Muslim communities in the West to harassment. Over 130 acts of Islamophobia have been perpetrated in France since the Charlie Hebdo attacks. But most Muslims simply do not accept that publishing those images or some of the images of the Prophet is just about, you know, exercising freedom of expression. And last Friday, I attended the prayer at the ISBC Friday Mosque, and the imam who delivered the sermon categorically, here in Boston, I mean, rejected the idea that these cartoons were just about freedom of expression. One comedian in France known as Jodoné wrote on Facebook that he was Charlie Koulibaly. He mixed the slogan, "I am Charlie," to support the murderous journalist, with the reference to the gunman Amedi Koulibaly. He was arrested and charged with supporting terrorism. It is possible that Jodoné is racist, but it's equally possible that most of those who were shouting, "I am Charlie," are motivated by hatred for Islam and Muslims and intolerance than defending freedom. In France, there are many civil rights groups, many pro-immigrant groups, such as the movements against racism and for friendship between people. There are equally many racist and anti-Muslim groups. An event like the Charlie Hebdo attacks provide the opportunity to promote Islamophobia and hatred. Just like most African heads of states, the president of Nigeria condemned the Charlie Hebdo killings. But according to the last issue of the weekly Jenafrique, issue 2819 of the week between January 18 and 24, the Nigerian president remained silent about the crimes of a greater magnitude perpetrated in his country. On January the 3rd, 2015, Boko Haram attacked Baga and took control of the military base used by a multinational force set up to fight them. The town was burned and the people massacred. Estimates of death toll is about 2,000 people. So this is believed to be the ugliest massacre of its history, and this event has gone largely unnoticed, and none of the West African heads of states who had joined the rally in Paris, you know, have joined any rally to denounce what Boko Haram did. Although West African states have created ECOWAS, the Economic Community of West Africa, to deal with regional security, they have been incapable of suppressing Boko Haram. To conclude, I think that the dialogue between the Senegalese and the French about right to caricature is likely to be a dialogue of the deaf. None is likely to convince the other. The truth is that Islam is not, that the truth is not Islam as opposed to satire, because satire and caricature exist also in the Muslim tradition. The question is, what is the degree of satire or caricature which is acceptable to Muslims? I think that the last issue with the representation, I am Charlie, everything is forgiven, wouldn't have shocked me personally as a Muslim. But in the websites, there are some pornographic images about the Prophet and statement about the Quran that would hurt the 1.5 billion Muslims living in the world. So I conclude with a few questions. Is the motivation of these cartoonists only to make people laugh? Or is it about marketing and selling more and more? Because we know that many, many French have a negative opinion of Islam. Is it Islamophobia or racial hatred? I have no sympathy for jihadi ideology, but if I was in Paris, I wouldn't have joined the rally Je suis Charlie, because I am not Charlie. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and Jeffrey Seul.
So, if we focus narrowly on the perspectives and actions of the Charlie Hebdo attackers and their victims on the magazine staff, I think there are very few contemporary situations that seem to me, at least, to be more polarized and intractable. Restricting our field of vision in this way, one may well be inclined to characterize our current situation as a hopeless clash of civilizations. Polarized perspectives like these share certain characteristics. They are partial narratives with foregone conclusions, and partial in two senses of that word. They exclude information and perspectives that won't fit neatly into the narrative, and then they sift and they interpret the remaining information perspective in biased ways. And these neat little stories we tell lead to seemingly inevitable conclusions, often justifying extreme, coercive, and even violent action. Civilizations, cultures, whatever they are, whatever their contestable contours may be, are obviously never monolithic and static. They're internally diverse and dynamic, and the polarized narratives tend to lose their coherence and sense of inevitability as we both widen our field of vision and sharpen our focus within it. And as we open up to the true messiness of this or any other situation, resisting overly neat little narratives, I believe we can begin to see practical possibilities for shifting the dynamic over time. Ways to begin making a seemingly intractable situation tractable. As I've listened to and read many diverse voices over the last couple of weeks, I've realized the messiness of my own perspectives on the situation. I found myself wanting tentatively at least to affirm many perspectives, even when they seem to diverge, and even when they sound a bit cacophonous together. I say no to the violence and the killing, of course. There's too much killing, and not only in Paris, and not only in the name of militant forms of Islam. But I say yes to free speech, and yes to exercising that right responsibly, and even yes to possible curtailment of the free speech norm in some cases. And yes to possible reappraisal of contemporary Islamic norms regarding blasphemy, as some Muslim intellectuals have urged. Yes to not holding the vast number of moderate Muslims responsible for the actions of the relatively very small, but not to be ignored, and demonstrably potent, very small percentage of Muslims who are violently militant. And yes to encouraging even more reflective speech and action from those same moderate Muslims in response to these dynamics. Yes, I suppose, to police and military protection, but emphatically yes to concerns about living in a police state and exacerbating tensions and perpetuating violence through dominant Western states' excessive show of force to extend and safeguard their interests. In one way to open up to the true messiness of the situation and to begin to discover practical options for shifting the current dynamic is dialogue within and between communities, as several people have observed. And there have indeed been many calls for dialogue following the Charlie Hebdo attack. Prime Minister Manuel Valls has acknowledged that he intended to spark a vigorous debate this week by saying that a territorial, social, and ethnic apartheid exists within France. Federica Mogherini, the EU representative for foreign affairs and security, said this week that we need a dialogue to face the issue of terrorism. And when asked about the Charlie Hebdo cartoons depicting the Prophet, Iran's foreign minister, Mohammad Javad Zarif, mused that the world would be a nicer place if everyone respected everyone else's opinion. And he added, unless we learn to respect one another, it will be very difficult in a world of different views and different cultures and civilizations. We won't be able to engage in a serious dialogue, he said. But calls to dialogue generally are just that. Little is offered in terms of the who and what and how and why of these proposed dialogues. And fledgling efforts at dialogue too often are ill-conceived and so fizzle or fall short. When they do occur, they often occur exclusively through highly formalized and constrained legal, political, and diplomatic mechanisms. The organization of which I'm a part, the Peace Appeal Foundation, helps stakeholders in conflicts create and sustain their own broadly inclusive peace and national dialogue processes. And we think a lot about how authentic, constructive, and ultimately action-oriented conversations can begin and be sustained in highly complex, charged, and usually violent situations. So I'd like to offer a thought or two about some of the qualities dialogues about our current situation must have in order to produce change over the long term. And I'll focus just on three qualities briefly of genuine dialogue that seem especially germane to the events and controversies we're considering tonight. The first quality I'll emphasize is the need for honest, analytical attention to the dialogue context, including history. Prime Minister Valls drew attention to part of the context in history in France that must help frame any dialogue about free speech in that country and the violence against the staff of Charlie Hebdo and other victims. And that history extends back over 100 years to include the brutal French imperial regime in Algeria, from which a hugely disproportionate number of French Muslims come. It includes the fact that by some estimates, more than 50% of French prison inmates come from the roughly 7% of the population that is Muslim. The context includes the history of the cartoon controversy in Denmark. And some respected analysts believe that that was really not so much about free speech, but about growing xenophobia in Denmark and across Europe. And as Stanley Fish, a Berkeley scientist, political scientist, wrote Tuesday in the Washington Post blog, the context also includes the fact that in the contemporary world, Christians won big, as he put it. Christians drew the boundaries of the states, he says, in which most Muslims live. Currently, people in Christian countries make up 1/3 of the world's population while holding 2/3 of its wealth and 9/10 of its military might. Fish is bringing the empirical tools of social science to this discussion with real discipline and respectful, unbiased curiosity, I believe. And I commend to you highly his 2013 book, Are Muslims Distinctive? A Look at the Evidence, which dispels a lot of, which presents a mixed picture, but dispels a lot of stereotypes about Muslims, including the idea that they're more violent. The second quality is the spirit in which people meet. All must be willing to meet others on their own terms, as they are. Gerard Biard, Charlie Hebdo's chief editor, told journalist Scott Sayer in 2005 that you are not supposed to use religion for your sense of identity. In principle, Arabs in France are not Muslims, he said, asking, how is it going to help these people to make them believe they're Muslims? Well, I'm sorry. The religious sense of identity is genuine, and there can be no real dialogue unless that's acknowledged. In real dialogue is hard for everyone. It's going to be hard for Muslims as well. Finally, on the substance, on the principles and policies and practices at stake in any dialogue, I'd emphasize the need for openness to compromise. Even some compromise of principles we hold most dear when that's required to serve other principles we hold dear or principles others hold dear. Trade-offs are unavoidable in life, even when we pretend they're not, even when they're taboo, because our identities are bound tightly to certain traditions or values, including values like free speech. And as I consider as much as I consider myself a proponent of free speech, I do find myself deeply questioning the wisdom of extending absolute legal protection backed by police force to a specific type of speech to which so few members of the culture with which I identify care to pay attention, and so many members of relatively poor minority populations in those countries find so deeply offensive. None of us has all the answers. Durable solutions to problems we all face will only emerge over time from dialogue within and among communities, as so many people now seem to be acknowledging. And if they occur, and I hope they really will, these dialogues must be structured and sustained very purposefully and very skillfully.
Thank you so much to all of the panelists. You want something?
Yes.
I think that you agree that it, I want to thank also the audience for your patience in sitting still for a long time, but I think you'll agree that it was very much worth our while. Really excellent and edifying and provocative presentations. I'd like to have a good opportunity for voices from the floor. And so what I would request of you all is please keep your comments short. You can also direct questions at the speakers. But what I would like to do maybe is, even though you direct a question at the speaker, maybe just have a chance for a bunch of people to speak first. We don't have a lot of time, and I really do want to hear from the audience. So we have a microphone going around.
Thank you very much. My name is Jonathan Solarte. I'm a grad student in French and Francophone studies. And my remarks and question are directed primarily at Daniela and at Ousmane. So I teach French here at Harvard. If any of my students or any French students are here, please come see me and sign up. shameless plug. So I have a few observations, and this semester I'm teaching a course about Paris, and I want to know how can I teach about freedom of speech while also being mindful about its intersections with systemic racism. So I have a few observations, like, for example, the idea of satire, and that mocking all is what has been happening, but we live in an unequal world, so mocking all, what injuries are we adding to when we mock all? How to be sensitive about that when I'm teaching to my students. Empathy for those who were killed, of course, but recognition that not all bodies are considered worthy of mourning. That violence against Muslims and people of color by the state is not talked about as terrorism. So the forgetting about, for example, the Norwegian white supremacist terrorist in Europe, that hasn't really been talked about as a recent terrorist attack, and yet the 2005 uprisings in the banlieue around Paris do get talked about as, characterized negatively. There was the NAACP bombing, unfortunately, in the US that hasn't been talked about as a terrorist attack because its victims were people of color. Recognition of France's colonial and imperial past and its ties with immigration today. Freedom of speech, yet pro-Palestine demos are banned and in France, and notorious anti-free speech figures were present at the demonstration for Charlie Hebdo, so sort of that hypocrisy there. I just have a lot of things here, but I'll kind of just wrap it up, and if there's anything that you can help me so I can teach my students being cognizant of all of these systemic racist things, I would really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. I would rather actually hear from a few people, and then maybe the panelists can address several of the questions. Yeah, over there, please.
Hi, my name is Mohamedou Jang. I'm a third-year MDiv. And I have a few comments that are mostly tied to what Anila and Professor Khan said. And it's basically, what constitutes really a national tragedy? Because in my own experience, as a black person, as an African, as a Muslim, to me, I think that, yes, the Charlie Hebdo killings were tragic, but I also think the fact that a week later they produced an issue that also featured images of the Prophet and sold 5 million copies in France and the world is tragic. I also think that in the wake of all this, a movie like American Sniper existing is tragic and making a lot of money as well. And so I just want to understand to what extent in which is the language and concept of national tragedy really framed in the devaluing and ignoring of sufferings of people who look like me and a lot of people in this room, and just to what extent can, what exactly can the few who are in positions of power, like academic power or linguistic power or religious authority, can really do to, make justice more cognizant with our histories and more, more representative of the real subjectivities that are suffering right now. I don't know if that made any sense.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Yes, up there, first. No.
Hi, Ali Sitar, second-year MTS student. I'm actually just curious if Mr. Seul would comment on who exactly might be the actors involved in the sort of dialogue that he was talking about.
Excellent question. Let's just hold these and get a few more. Yes, over here.
Thank you. My name is Virginie Green. I'm French. I'm professor of French. And I am the chair of the Department of Romance Languages and Literature at Harvard. Thank you all for talking. That's great that you were able to put this dialogue together so fast. I hope we will continue in various ways to do that across, and I like to be kept posted of what you do and to try to keep you posted of what we will attempt probably to do. The only thing I want to do is to say, so many things, it's very hard to understand the pain of other people and the mourning of other people. I'm sorry, I'm in mourning for Charlie. That's all I can say. And all your arguments, I hear you. And there are plenty of true things you said about something that people actually did, which was irresponsible and so forth. But my sister called me, woke me up, and told me, Kabu has been killed. And we cried. And, well, you can say it's silly. I'm a white, powerful person, privileged person. I don't deny that. I'm a professor at Harvard, okay? But there was real pain. Okay, my pain may be frivolous compared to many much bigger pain that other people in the world feel, but there was a real pain, and that's why you had so many people in the street in France. It's silly to say that, but it was a story of love. Sorry. There was politics, but there was a real love, even by people who didn't care about the Charlie or didn't read it. All of a sudden, they said, no, that's something which makes us French. Mm.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Some other comments? There's one over here. Yes. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Sarah Bracke, and I'm at the Center for the Study of World Religions and also at the Center for European Studies. It's a different kind of comment. I'm wondering about how in many of the commentaries on what happened, and I also think in the conversation here today, how the categories of religion and race are sometimes confused, how we skip from one to the other, how they are actually co-constructed at the same time. And I also have a feeling, but this is not, I'm wondering if other people have visions on that, that there's also something very particular European going on there. And I'm actually reminded of a commentary that Du Bois made on a trip to Europe, and I think it was Poland, I don't remember the exact quote anymore, where he arrived in Poland and made a comment on how religion and race were intertwined in a way that he, of course, the scholar of race, didn't recognize in the US. So I don't know if people have thoughts about that, but I do have an intuition that there's something really important going on in this conflation, and that as on the scholarly part, that we should understand what is going on here.
Thanks very much, very good question. Other people who would like to speak? Yes, sir. Yeah.
Thanks. My name is Mustafa Kara Ali. I'm a postdoc in theology here at HDS. I wanted to talk, maybe forward my question to Anila and Ousmane. The approach I would like to take is related to the issue of justice. Now, justice could be approached in two ways, as an absolute, whereby we could disagree and then part, or as a practical matter of practical justice, whereby the empirical evidence or the evidence of today give us a way forward. And I'd like to quote from the Quran on exactly this issue, so we might seek guidance. And the verse says, وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. And the verse says, do not mock, curse, or swear against those that they call besides God, that they may curse, mock, or swear against God. And so the issue here that emerges for me is it's a matter of practical justice. So we might disagree on the absolutes, but in practical justice terms, we would have to note what is happening here. And if those cartoons are enticing terrorism, to put it in a legal framework, if they are enticing terrorism, then they should be outlawed. Simple.
Any other comments, and then we can turn briefly to the panelists. Yes, sir, yes.
I was going to add something to what he said, that the Buddha has mentioned that the hatred never is ceased by hatredness. If you are being a cartoonist and if you spread hatredness, I think what they are doing is something really wrong. And if you can spread peace through your cartoons, that brings some solutions to the terrorism. And in any religion, I find that even in Buddhism, we have extremist Buddhist terrorist monks, even in a place like Sri Lanka, which is a Buddhist country. So for us, the ignorance of not knowing the difference between hatredness and peace is the issue we are having. And we have to start within ourselves to speak gently, to spread this peace, and really listen to the message of the peace and then write or use our freedom of speech or draw curtains or whatever to spread the divine message of peace to the world, I think. Otherwise, it's like karma. It comes back to you. Thank you.
All right, thank you for a wide range of comments. And we just have a bit of time. I want to just allow any of the panelists who wish to respond to any of the comments or questions. Can we just start, Anila, from your side, and just go down the line? And you don't have to say anything if you don't have anything to say. But make it brief, whatever it is.
But whatever all of you. I might have to maybe say. Okay, Jonathan. I had the blessing and fortune to meet Jonathan actually in Paris. He was the superb translator to a talk my brother was given, and we happened chance met there. But it was I appreciate your question about teaching materials. I think you will do an outstanding job from what I've learned of you, but and of your comments here. But you know, just right off the top of my head, I would what has worked for me. In teaching anthropology and trying to give people a lens to look at the lives of dispossessed people in metropolitan centers. The movie La Haine works very well for me, and I'm sure you're aware of that. But it is a movie that speaks about the marginalized immigrant communities, and it's done quite well. And then just simply Battle of Algiers, but of course I know that's something you know as well based on the talk in Paris. We can talk more, Jonathan, about that, so please don't think that I'm not giving more thought to your thing. Because you raised some very, very good points, and I would love to be a student in your class. Mamadou, your question about what constitutes a national tragedy, much less an international one, is quite profound, and it's not only profound because that's what I tried to ask in my talk, but that's not why it's profound. It's literally what it does, you know, and that's it really makes me think. In Peshawar, yes, 148 school children and their teachers were massacred. They were going to school with books in their hands and love and knowledge in their hearts and these things. And I don't have an answer to that. I do like the questions that you brought up and the way you're thinking, if that helps. But I don't know how to answer that, but hopefully we could move forward and learn and discuss this more together. I certainly think this valuing of lives differently in grievable and mournable bodies is what I try to attend to in my brief comments. And I'm not sure how it is that, and I know it's related to colonialism and vestiges of that that lives on that makes black and brown bodies just not count. So I don't know, because I would hate to say that, but. And that's why, again, that's the thread through my talk. I just don't understand how thousands in this one incident in Nigeria and 148 school children and teachers, I don't want to just say that it's race, but there's something about value and what is valued, and I don't know if that's related to capitalism. I know it's certainly related to racism, but I do have a sense it's also related to capitalism, but I don't know why, how. Something is valued differently. And it's certainly not 148 school children and their teachers trying to get to school. Okay, Sarah, so, really quickly, yeah. Your quote on Dubois, I missed it. I would, if somebody else wants to pick that up, because I did miss the quote and when it, you know, so I'm sorry, hopefully somebody could pick that up.
Yes.
And Mustafa. I'm not sure what practical justice is, I'm sorry, but I would love to learn more what you have in mind, but I do, you know, with the idea of freedom of speech, yes, we all have freedoms, but it's how it is that we use those to enlighten or to insult. And for me, I that's what I tried in my comments to say, that for me, They were the journalists were exercising their freedom of speech, but I think they were bullies. And I don't know what that does about practical justice, but we can talk more so I can understand more your concept of justice. And to the professor of French, I'm very sorry for the pain that you've experienced and that you will continue to process and whatnot. And that's
it. Thank you. Mark, do you have any comments?
Let me just make a quick one. It seems to me important to mark at a divinity school that for some of our traditions at least, we would put a question mark beside the hope that human effort by itself would produce durable solutions to these problems.
Give that a moment to sink in.
That was dramatic.
Jocelyne, just a word or so?
I have two words. To pick up on the question intersection between religion and race, I think, and it goes back to what is the specificity of Paris, I think we should not underestimate the importance of the religious or the status of religion in the public culture of France and how it can be offensive to people who have religious conviction. And indeed, it would be misleading to bury the debate, and I'm not saying it's not important, about immigration, about color, about race. I mean, if you are a convert to Islam today, you are facing the same kind of a challenge that someone who is the son of an immigrant Muslim family. I think we have to be clear on that. And it means that we have to look a little deeper from this side of the Atlantic to the fact that there is a specific history of religion in the public culture of France and all over Europe. And it is not enough to also say they are bad. And I agree with you on that. I mean, there is something in the history of what makes a citizen in Europe that is different from the American way. And it has to be acknowledged as such. And I feel a little uncomfortable about all the implicit condemnation and the thing that indeed we may be good and condemn, but I want to address here the anxiety of the young people who are not Muslim and who look horribly Islamophobe from this part of the ocean. What I'm looking at now is how they are joining extreme right movements, like the young people can be attracted to Al-Qaeda and ISIS, and what it means. And I don't want to do predictions, but there are tensions all over Europe across this young. So what do we do? Who is good and who is bad? And I think we have to be very clear when we do scholarship that we have the dialogical position and not just, you know, it's easy to be on one side or another. It's much difficult to try to take both sides and make sense of it.
Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. Charlie. Ousmane. And Jeffrey.
I had a very specific question and on the who's included in these dialogues, and I think there are lots of people imagining lots of different types of dialogues, and so there are probably different answers to this, to that question. But in the situations in which we work, in which it typically involve a whole country, the answer in principle is everyone, and obviously that's unmanageable, and so large numbers of people in processes that are structured in very different ways as the circumstances dictate, as people agree. So the answer is, I don't know, but in principle, broadly inclusive of every perspective that needs to be included. And on the durable solutions thing, those were my words, and that's a point well taken, really. Perhaps a better way to a better notion might be some altered dynamic in which maybe the processes our relations are less marked by tragedies like we've seen recently. But you're right, the situation will always be dynamic.
Well, we've come to the end of our time period. I want to really thank both the audience and the panelists just simply for being here together and thinking together and talking together about some really difficult but yet very, very important issues. So thank you all for attending, and good night.